this is the third of what will be dozens of events designed to celebrate and commemorate the 50th anniversary of the opening of the college system. For those of you who don't know, the first students moved into the first college back on March 27th, 1957. That's when some students moved their belongings into Will Rice College. And four other colleges followed suit within the next 5 or so weeks. Today is also an interesting day because we're getting close to the 50th anniversary of the first beer bike, which occurred the same year, also won by Will Rice College. Was Baker?
Yeah.
Are
it
you
was
sure?
Baker.
Then we need to check. We need to check Will Rice's stated history. I do know that in some sense, Hansen crossed the finish line first, but was disqualified for having taken a shortcut, for whatever that's worth. I don't want to spend too much time. You know, we've had this is the third panel. The first panel was a fascinating panel on the origins of the college system, where we had some representatives of the committee that wrote the first report in 1956, establishing a vision for the college system. We also saw the unveiling of the design for McMurtry College. The next panel was on the present college system, which was a really wonderfully candid discussion of both some remarkable positive elements of the college and the way we've, succeeded in achieving some of those goals, probably to a greater extent than anyone ever imagined, but also there are other aspects of the goals that we still have some work to do on. And today, the focus of this conversation is on the future of the college system, and of course, the fact that there will be a new college is part of that, but that's not the focus. The focus is on, even what Will Rice and Baker and Martell and others will look like in the decades ahead. The colleges, as we've heard in the last couple panels, have evolved in some significant ways over the last 50 years, and obviously they'll continue to evolve whether we like it or not. And so the question is what we'd like to see them evolve to. Before we get going, I want to recognize some people both in the audience and on the panel. It's been fun to take this opportunity to kind of recognize those people who have played a particularly prominent role in helping the colleges succeed as much as they have. So if those of you who are current or former resident associates, could you please stand to be recognized? You too. As I've said in other settings, the resident associates in many ways have the hardest job in the college because it's the least well-defined. So they have the greatest flexibility on deciding how to contribute, but they come into the job and they have for 50 years without a roadmap. And those who are here have all found their own path to make remarkable contributions to the colleges and to the lives of the students. And how about current and former masters? You have a... Well, it's just you? I thought, okay. Well, I forgot. Thank you very much. So, the masters, even though in many ways have the shortest, when you look at the RAs, college coordinators, and masters, the masters have the shortest term. It's kind of a contradictory situation that they're viewed as the heart and soul of the college system. And in many ways, they symbolize what makes the college system and not a dormitory system or a fraternity. But they play a role that is very different than the others. And we don't have any college coordinators here. They've attended the other panels, but we certainly can't forget the college coordinators, who are very much the emotional glue of the colleges. They carry with them not just the life stories of every student who passed through the hallways, but in many ways also the institutional memory, serving in many cases for well over 20 years in the college and training many generations of RAs and masters along the way. So I'd like to quickly introduce the panel. My role here will be to serve as moderator and just mention topics at some point, field questions, and then to get out of the way and let the panelists respond. Over on this side, we have Priscilla Parrett, who's a senior at Martell College. We have Dr. Jeremy Grace, who's a lecturer in communications, assistant director of the debate and speech club, and a former resident associate at Martell College. Mike Wolf, who's chairman of the Department of Mathematics and a new master at Will Rice College. Clint Corcoran, who's a senior at Will Rice College. And Sara Zampierin, who's a senior at Baker College and has just stepped out of the role of president of Baker College. So I thought we might as well just jump right into the big question that I've been asking every panel. The committee in in 1956 established a number of goals for the college system. And they include the idea, the notion of building community, fostering student self-governance, providing a place where students and faculty can interact in kind of unplanned but ultimately productive ways, and encouraging a cultural and intellectual life outside of the college. And so I just thought we'd begin by talking about where, you know, it's hard to separate the future from the present, so your sense of where we are now and in what directions we should evolve to more successfully achieve these goals. So Clint, you're nodding, and that's so why don't you start? I hope that's not a bad lesson for the rest of you. I want you to nod and be engaged. But
Well, student self-governance has actually been a really strong thing that the Rice residential college system brings. An example I can think of today that I've been putting together a 50th anniversary documentary video for Will Rice. And we're showing it tonight at 7 p.m., so we need to put it in there in the comments and project it and all this. So we need to know how are we gonna project it. So I've been working all day with trying to coordinate with people, putting up a screen, getting the projector, covering the light in the comments, figuring out how to buy the materials we need, where do we get a big ladder, where do we get tape, just things like that. And those are daily activities that we do. And since we are self-governed, we can find the committees to spend money for that. We can find the students that we need to help put it up. It's kind of like a community that we come together. I conscripted, is what I say. I kind of recruited some people this afternoon so I could be here and they could help build some of the screen to put up there. But it's just that kind of self-governance that allows us to continue on what we have, and hopefully we'll build that in the future.
I'll jump in. So before the panel started, maybe I don't move this. As master of this college, you know, I'm hoping this thing all works out very well that Clint's doing. And so he gave me very much a description of what he just gave you. And I exercised my leadership ability in my leadership role, and I said, good. And so that's, well done, Clint. I'm sure it'll work. Okay. So, I see. So that's a difference. So, I mean, so the leadership really works. And it's great for the students, it's great for the masters, it's great for the college system. And there's a tremendous amount of educational value that comes from these sorts of activities. I mean, one often hears a lot about maybe the intellectual atmosphere in the colleges. And there's lots of more or less baseless rancor on campus about the lack of this. But there's a tremendous amount that I think that goes on in the colleges sometimes in subtle ways. And so this sort of self-governing is one thing. I think there's a tremendous amount of management experience and leadership experience that come from that. And one example that was sort of striking to me this year is that Will Rice decided that they wanted to resurrect their theater program. So we have a person who took charge of the theater program. And so she hired a director and a technical director and a business manager and maybe some others. Those people hired others, they engaged in marketing, and in the end, a show went up. And so there's maybe an organization that was built from scratch, just four levels deep by a sophomore. And a lot of people worked very hard. They read scripts. I mean, maybe this is, I don't know if this literary analysis is, the same as what one does in some advanced class on deconstruction, but you know, they thought about what would work in the environment and what they wanted to do. And so all these things together, I mean, I think are part and parcel of the university experience, part and parcel of the education.
From an ex-president's perspective, I just wanted to say that it's going to be really interesting looking forward to see how, with the addition of one new college and maybe two new colleges, how the college governments interact with the university-wide government. Right now, I think the college governments are really strong. A lot of times, organizations such as the Committee on the Rice Undergraduate Program will come directly to the colleges to hear feedback, and the university-wide meetings are not as well attended. People tend to associate with their college. They like doing things with their college. They like people coming to their own college and getting opinions. But it will be interesting to see, with the addition of two more colleges, how that plays out and how the role of the SA changes with that.
Kind of going along with that, I think another thing is, even with the way the leadership is now within the college system, a lot of people don't feel like they can get into that leadership structure, or that it's, you know, just a political thing or a popularity thing like it was any other place. But that also forces people to go out into the university and get leadership positions in other groups where maybe they feel more comfortable. I think that the small nature of how everything is at Rice makes it so that people feel like they can get a leadership position, even if it isn't within their own residential college, someplace else around campus. And hopefully, as we move forward and get larger as a university and larger as a student body, we'll continue to have those kinds of opportunities for students where they can gain leadership experience, even if they can't do it within their own college in other places.
I think it's hard to talk about the future of the Rice College system without sort of inherently having a referendum on the present. And I think you'll hear a lot of that when thinking about the future. And while I would agree with all of the things that have been said as far as that there is intellectual activity at the college and self-governance is a good thing, I wonder if we haven't, if we couldn't in the future look to the college system for a number of opportunities. Every college has a tremendous budget, and they spend that budget how they want to. And I think there's a majority, not a majority, but there's certainly a large portion of students who might say that they spend it, that they try to spend it primarily on fun activities, namely beer. I wonder if in the future, if we couldn't reconcile our college budgets with the call of the future and the call to conversation. We want to engage Houston, so why not let every college self-govern, but say, hey, 5% of your budget is going to be an outreach program. Another 5% of that budget is going to be bringing in a scholar from somewhere around the country or the world to increase this intellectual activity, and give a certain amount of guidelines so that we could gently nudge the things we all dream and want to see in the college and make them, bring them to fruition.
Thank you. I do have one comment on self-governance. Some of you may know there's a delegation of leaders from Chinese universities visiting campus these 2 weeks. It's actually a remarkable event with presidents and vice presidents from the top universities in China. And one question that I've been asked on a number of occasions is that, given the slightly more restrictive culture there for children, it's difficult for them to get their students to think creatively about problems. And how should a university think about encouraging free thinking and creativity, a creative approach to problem solving? And one of the answers I gave is that the self-governance, the philosophy of self-governance, in some sense mandates that students approach problems in creative ways without seeking well-worn paths, and often there is no well-worn path, and they're forced to approach problems in new ways. One aspect of the goals which no one commented on is that the colleges were designed to be a place where students and faculty interact in substantial ways. As we heard from Bert McMurtry, who was one of the student representatives on the committee, they ultimately decided they wouldn't say how the faculty and students would interact. The idea was, if they did, good things would happen. And that's as far as they thought. And in fact, they thought they would ultimately, by clarifying it further, they would in fact ultimately restrict the possibilities. Just to set a stage for the question, there's a sense now on the part of many that the faculty associate program is suffering. That was mentioned in an op-ed piece in The Thresher a while ago, and I've heard it mentioned from others. On the other hand, what we heard from people discussing the past of the college system, and what's become apparent in documents we found, is that the faculties, at every stage of the college system, it's felt like the faculty associates program was struggling and near collapse. So with that as context, I think we all, and again, I don't want to put words in the nose, I think we all believe that the faculty-student interaction is fundamental to the notion of the college system. I think we also understand that mealtime, which is when most interactions occur, is changing. It's not just changing at Rice, it's changing across America. The idea of a family-style dinner no longer holds true even in families, right, with everyone sitting down to talk and exchange ideas. So tell me what you think is going on with the faculty associates program and what should be going on. What should we look towards the future with what goals should we have in mind?
I think I have a unique perspective. I actually think I had a great faculty associate experience. The people who I went to dinner with in my freshman year, I've kept in touch with all 4 years. I've gone to various cultural events around Houston. Every time they come and visit Rice for lunch, I'm always there. But I do see that a lot of other students aren't getting that kind of same experience from their faculty associate because maybe that person's busy and can't stop by the college all the time, or they aren't around. I think that it is at a good place now. I don't think it's suffering as much as people say it is. Maybe it is at other colleges. I know at Martell, we have a great group of associates. But I think that in the future, we need to just be encouraging more associates to get involved. I think there are plenty of professors and staff members on campus that would love to get involved with their students and love to have a more personal relationship outside of a classroom, but aren't really sure how to do that or what the role of an associate is, or are wary about approaching students they, you know, would like to be approached. I think we just need to work on doing more outreach. I think it's a crucial part of the college system that we need to make sure is upheld and kept around.
Thanks. Sara?
I think that on one hand, we have a decent amount, Baker has a decent amount of activities that we invite our faculty members to. We just had an event where 20 students went to the Museum of Fine Arts with Dr. Manka, and he showed everyone around and showed them the new exhibit. But it's always easier to plan the sort of fun events. So those are the things that come up when you have extra money in the budget. And people get discouraged if maybe only 10 or 20 students show up to an event with a faculty member. But if you just keep planning events like that, they'll hit different people differently. You'll find a topic that you really connect with and that you really do want to discuss, or a professor that's coming to speak to our college that, you know, you're really interested in, you're really interested in their research. So I think it's important to keep doing those events, and a lot of that tends to come from the masters and the RAs organizing things, or, you know, getting excited about events like that.
Want to add something?
I can get used to this. So I think the associates program, as it's been traditionally arranged, is probably under great stress, maybe winding down. But I think the original goal is probably still there. It's still still accessible, and I still think it's still important. From what I see, there's a substantial hunger on the part of the students for faculty contact. I think they enjoy it. I think they get a lot out of it. And I think there's something of a hunger in a good part of the faculty to get to know students and to be involved with them. And I should say, and also the administration and in other portions of the university, and somehow getting these folks together is the challenge. I think somehow there's additional pressures on faculty, and somehow within maybe the departments there's more of a priority on research productivity than there has been in the past, and less of a priority on interaction with students. So somehow at the local level, the emphases have changed. On the other hand, a lot of the faculty come to Rice because of their interest in students, because of their interest in the Rice students. And so when they have a given outlets to get beyond the sort of natural pressures, I think things come together. I have a debater over there. I better bolster this with something. We had, for instance, at Will Rice, say, bring your favorite faculty member to dinner, and groups of students invited 20-some faculty members and had a great dinner with them. I think those numbers will continue and grow. The faculty seem to really enjoy having a time and a place to talk to students when they're not lecturing to them. So I think it's a matter of finding the right arrangements for a new for new settings.
Jeremy?
I think I would probably steal from some conversations I've been having with Priscilla the last few days about this panel and say that ultimately anything that happens in the future isn't going to be up to anybody on the panel. It's not going to be up to Dr. Forman. It's ultimately going to be up to the undergraduates. And the future is, to sound corny, is really in your hands. And I think you can help I think you can help faculty-student interaction by doing that. You know, it's funny, I think a lot of faculty really want more interaction with students, and a lot of students really want more interaction with faculties, but we all get together sometimes, and everybody reverts sort of back to this junior high school dance, and we don't approach one another, and I think we all just have to take initiatives at the college level to approach one another and to say, hey, I'm very interested in being an active part of your life, and I'm interested in knowing what you have to teach me. On a very simple level, I think an interesting thing would be for this panel or your office to explore just merely double listing faculty courses as college courses, just to get that interaction. I know as a faculty member, one of my favorite times of any day is having Martellians in my class and being able, after class, to walk back to lunch with them. And just that nice long walk, and that interaction is really important to me, and it's meant a lot to me as an RA.
Yeah.
I, as a master, I also taught a course just before lunch, and I remember those moments. They are very special. I want to ask a question. It in some ways it reflects on your question that sometimes there are members of the college who basically don't feel included in decisions about how money is spent. I've heard it discussed some ways differently, that the college, that there is in some ways a mainstream culture in a college, and the cabinet reinforces that mainstream culture, but not everyone feels part of that mainstream culture. And this was something that was brought up at the last panel on the college system at present. And we also heard about it in the day-long forum on commemorating the 40th anniversary of the matriculation of the first African-American students at Rice. The challenges of welcoming a diverse community into the colleges is just going to increase. Some of you may know this year 6% of our entering class included non-US citizens, international students, doubling the percentage last year. And that percentage is only going to increase. So can you speak about the challenges currently faced and increasingly faced in the future, and how the colleges may go about addressing those challenges? So again, you're nodding, so you get to start.
I get to go first. I was shocked as a freshman to find out that our college budget was almost as big as my mom's salary growing up. And then even more shocked when we got towards the end of the year, when I realized that there were people coming to our college asking for money for spring break trips, you know, alternative spring break trips to go build houses in, you know, the South, or specifically at the end of the year when our water polo team, who was going to nationals, came and asked us for money, and they wanted, you know, like $50, and we had a huge argument in Parliament about whether or not we could afford $50 out of our budget for, you know, our pub night for that, you know, spring to help our water polo team, who was representing our university to the nation, go. And I was appalled by that fact. So I think that something needs to be done to rethink how a lot of the money at colleges is spent. Sure, I love the social events. I go to all the social events too. I'm not anti-social events or think that we shouldn't have them, but when you're entrusted with such a large amount of money, I think that we need to be careful about how we spend it, especially, you know, I know a lot of the colleges have bleeding hearts budgets, but they're usually very small. Why would you not want to support, you know, other people at your university who are doing great things and going out representing you to the rest of the world? Why would you not want to make Rice look better and all these other activities by helping these students, you know, go out and do this kind of thing? So I think as the colleges get bigger and more students, and you have a more diversity of opinions about this, I think there needs to be a change in the way the budgets are structured, and not just by the executive council, whoever those people may be.
I never heard the phrase bleeding hearts budget.
Maybe it's just Martell. I guess it's like, it's our charity budget. Where, you know, we have a certain amount of money in, and then if people come wanting money for, you know, their alternative spring break trips, we'll give them $25. And then we've restricted it again so that we'll only give certain amounts of money out to Martell people. And if there aren't any Martellians involved in your project, you won't get as much money, even though we're all Rice students.
Well, it's interesting because coming from the perspective of somebody that's planned out the budgets, it's hard to know what the budgets are for. Like, should we be giving money to university-wide events when we are charged with providing things for Baker College? It's an interesting idea, and all the colleges treat things differently. Baker doesn't give any money to any outside organizations unless they're putting on a study break for us or doing some sort of thing that involves the entire college. So I think it would be interesting if all the colleges talked about that and kind of came to some conclusion, especially now that with the new colleges are going to be bigger than the rest of them. They're probably going to have bigger budgets if we keep assigning budgets by per student. And it will be interesting to see the different resources that and events that they plan with those resources.
But can you say something in your role as president between balancing activities that, say, appeal to the majority of the college and also your the challenge of kind of welcoming all the students in the college to feel part of the community?
I feel that at Baker, we are small enough that almost everyone who has an opinion comes and says, can I have money to do this event? And we say, okay. We have a budget specifically designed as the initiative fund, where if you want to throw some sort of study break and you're not on cabinet or it doesn't fit into any other budget that we already have, you can use that money. So I don't know, though, if our college gets bigger or with some of the bigger colleges, it's not as easy to reach out to every single person. And it's hard to plan a variety of events sometimes when you have laid out every year before you the parties that you've thrown and exactly how to do them.
A statement from Will Rice?
I can speak about the Will Rice budget a little bit. So I feel that we as a college do a fairly good job of distributing funds to different groups. For example, our master, Mike Wolf, just talked about the theater program that we just started. We didn't have any money really budgeted for them at the beginning of the year, but in the spring they wanted to put on this production, and we found $1,500 for them to do it out of our small budget. So I feel that when things are necessary, when things are important to the colleges do come around and do things that are necessary for the college. Another example, we have a philanthropy budget, which is kind of similar to the other ones that were talked about, I guess. And one thing that we have built in as a line item is the parking for our chefs and our kitchen staff. So we build that in as part of our philanthropy. So we basically, going back to self-governance, we kind of decide where we want to distribute money. And as a diet, is what our student government is called, we vote on it. We have long discussions about where to distribute this money. And I feel that we do give it to many organizations. We help sponsor Spontaneous Combustion when they went to a Northeast tour for their comedy trip. So we do sponsor all these different groups of campus activities that involve some Will Ricers that are involved. So I feel that the equity of funds is spent pretty well for Will Rice's, on Will Rice's position.
Jeremy?
Sure, it's a difficult question. And I just wanna make sure I got the question correct. How can we be more inclusive with our college budgets?
Well, not necessarily with the college budgets, but just, I can see why, I began the question that way and then ended up somewhere else. Just the notion that the challenge to be inclusive will become more difficult in the coming years. That's clear. I mean, the college populations will become more diverse. And how can the colleges evolve to better meet that challenge?
I think maybe by putting the challenge at the forefront of everything that the college does, and that might even change in merely rhetoric. One of the things I know that we do at Martell, we refer to ourselves often as a community rather than a college. And you know, putting a line item, I like the line item idea, just saying, how does this affect the community? And does this include people in our community? By just having that at the forefront of all of our endeavors, I would hope that I think that might change some of the things we do. And if you can't justify how it helps your community or your college, don't do it.
Mike?
Okay. Maybe it'll be controversial. I've been arguing with Robin for 20 years. No time to stop. So
we met each other long before either one of us came to Rice. So we just moved here to continue the arguments.
So, Robin, you fool. So so Robin says it will be that inclusiveness will be become increasingly more difficult as the colleges become more diverse, and that's clear. I think it's false. So one of the great strengths of the college, I think, is that there's an ideal in the college that trumps just about everything. The ideal of the college as a community, the ideal of the college as a single unit, and so two aspects of this come to mind. The first is that college as a force for tolerance and a force for uh, for diversity and for getting for people to get to know each other. I mean, there's the college is a mishmash of people from all sorts of backgrounds, and who I think in other settings would naturally gravitate away from each other. But the ideal of the college takes over, and it becomes a very high priority for folks in the college to get to know people in their class, in their college, no matter who they are, no matter where they are. So I think it's not clear to me that the fact that when there's greater diversity, there will be greater difficulty in getting unity. In fact, as the larger groups somehow thin out to represent more and more groups, I think this sort of toleration notion of the college as a single community will take over, make that melding work even better. Let's see. That's point one. I'll yield on point two. I also think these colleges are going to get larger and the community is going to get larger. I mean, there's been lots of debate about, how big should a college be. And actually, I think that the colleges are now, be a little more controversial, probably a little too small. So in the sense that there are some natural groups within the college that people can find the right, can identify with, occupies maybe two-thirds of the incoming freshmen. They can identify themselves as maybe in the religious group or maybe in the drinking group or maybe in some other group. And then there's a third of the college that really doesn't fit in one of the larger groups, and they kind of drift for a little while till they find enough kindred souls. And so I think with a larger college with more people and more diverse people, these people will find more support in smaller groups. I think that's a good thing.
Any response? I want to, just a couple more questions for the panel, and then we'll open it up for comments and questions. My next question has to do with another aspect of the changing campus. You know, traditionally there's been a view of Rice and just to state in somewhat caricature form, that when you came to Rice, you were safe behind the hedges, you were safe from the city, you never had to notice there was a big, terrible city out there, and even on the campus, you were safe within your college. You had a home, and there was really very few reasons to ever have to leave the college besides going to class. Okay, I understand that's an extreme view. But both elements of that view are being challenged now and intentionally and very forceful ways. There's a movement afoot that we'll see the groundbreaking on. You can see the stakes behind the library that will laying out the outline of the pavilion, which will be a cyber cafe meant to draw people from all over campus, students, graduate students, faculty, staff. We'll see construction begin at some point in the next 6 months, I hope, for a new rec center. With the idea of building a central, a vibrant communal spot with dynamic interactions. There's also very much an initiative to get students integrated into the camp community in all kinds of ways. The Passport to Houston program to help students make it more convenient and also less expensive for students to leave campus, go to museums, go to the symphony, go to the opera, and the Center for Civic Engagement. Get students to go off campus and pursue your passions in the community in ways that are integrated with your academic work. So the question is, how will this affect the role of the colleges on our campus?
I think that a lot of the efforts to get people off campus are really good and well-intentioned, because I think as a freshman and sophomore, when I lived on campus, it's very easy to not leave campus ever. You can get food delivered when there aren't meals on campus, and everything else you can possibly need is here. And so you get in that habit of just studying, you know, and going to class with people you know. But there are amazing things to do in Houston, and I don't think necessarily encouraging people to go off campus and experience Houston more will take anything away from the college experience. I think it'll just enhance it, because then people can bring those experiences back to their college with them and encourage more people to go enjoy the symphony or a musical or a museum.
In fact, I think that point was stressed in the response to the temporary plan to offer dinner on Saturdays, mm-hmm. right? Where the which that the goal was to strengthen the colleges. In fact, the students responded in great numbers to say it will weaken the colleges by keeping it a little too self-contained.
It's the only chance to go off campus. If you had an excuse was Saturday, I mean, if you had to go out to get dinner, at least you had to get off campus somehow and go find food or at least order something in. So I think it's good.
How about the idea of a kind of a, it's been, just to make the point, that I've been involved, I've been at Rice for 20 years, and I know that because they just gave me a clock that said that. So, and I've been involved in a number of conversations over the years where there was a decision made intentionally not to put something, especially food service, not to create too many attractive eating options around campus for fear of weakening the college system. There are a number of buildings built in the last two decades where it was proposed to have some kind of kitchen, and eventually was decided not to pursue that path. And yet now we are. I'll state my views. I think the grad students have suffered inappropriately in our efforts to strengthen the college system. And the grad students they don't have the faculty club and they don't have the colleges and they're left stranded. And I think providing some attractive alternatives for them is a significant positive step. But I think, that central, work on the central quad with the pavilion and the rec center and at some point a redesigned student center will. The goal is to create a really exciting place for students to be. Sara?
I think it's a great idea because I think a lot of times the people that end up getting turned off by the colleges and don't like to be around them is because they're so always inclusive. People are always there. You're always doing the same things with the same people. So maybe by having more options for the pavilion where you can go and study or go have coffee with one of your friends and actually have a place to sit there will build the college system in a way because people won't be so turned away from it. So it will be important, though, that the colleges still continue to plan a lot of activities, that people are still really invested in the colleges, but I don't think that it's adding more students and adding more buildings, resources is going to take away from it. I also think, going along with what Priscilla said about going off campus and having all the events like the symphony and stuff. The ones that work best, at least at Baker, are the ones that, even though Passport organizes them, we give out tickets because Baker is going as a college and people enjoy going with their friends and that's not going to change. People enjoy going with their college. That's your home base, your home community. And I think it works best when events like that are organized with the colleges in mind.
I'll have a really short comment about that. I think it could be somewhat dangerous to have some of these central locations to try to get students to come to, because I think it will take away from the college system a little bit, because some students, even though they don't feel like they're a part of that college, they will identify themselves as not part of that college and then go off and do other things with other groups of students. I think that's fine for Rice University as a whole, and that can be one of the goals of Rice, is to make all the students fit in some capacity, whether it's in the residential college, friends at other colleges, whatever, with a meet with faculty or graduate students or whoever. But I do think that it will have that tendency to kind of hurt the college system a little bit, in that some students will find that outlet better than their college themselves. So
I really disagree with that. I think the most effort we can make to make the colleges less insular, the stronger we will always make the colleges. And I think the new construction that's going on will give people a place to go and collect. And more than likely, those are the people you've probably haven't seen in a few years because they have nowhere else to go. Maybe sophomore year, maybe junior year, they decide the college system isn't for them. They go off campus or as people call it, deep OC, and we never see them again. I would like to see them again. You know, I see people every couple years and have forgotten that they are Martellians. Because maybe they didn't fit in somewhere and they had no other outlet or a place to be on campus where they could be
anonymous.
Yeah, there you go. Not anonymous, right. Thanks, Priscilla.
Okay.
I think one of the great things about Rice is how everything is contained on campus. There's a huge social network on campus as opposed to other universities where everyone moves off campus and doesn't really connect with each other on a day-to-day basis. So I think that by having more attractive places on campus for people to go and more opportunities will keep more of the people that have traditionally gone deep OC that don't like the colleges, and maybe they'll come around to the colleges a little bit more often.
I have one more question before opening up the floor, and that is, we talked a little bit about the potentially changing role of college government as the number of colleges increases. But what would you like to see in happen to the roles of both college, within the college government, RAs, coordinators, masters? How are those roles changing, and how perhaps should they be changing? Mike?
So, you know, invited to be on this panel about the future of the colleges. So I think it's, of course, a lot easier to, you know, I'm trying to think what I could possibly say about the future. I mean, it's a much easier to predict the present or the past. So, of course, I think just about everything we might say about the future is going to be false. But the one thing I think that maybe leads into everything is that the students are changing. In many ways, students always change. The student population always changes. Certainly, demographically, we know the students are changing. Robin will say that. The backgrounds change. The interests change. As a short introduction to this, I have a good friend who graduated from Harvard in class of 61. This is a post-Sputnik era, and he remarked to me that in his graduating class in 1961, 25% of the class went to graduate school in math, physics, or chemistry. So that does not happen here. And so it does not happen now. And so things change. I think there's a number of things I think changing about the students. They're brought up differently, they have different experiences. Robin remarked once to me, and so I'm glad he's here so he can say the correct numbers. There was a survey done recently where the question for incoming students was, who's your best friend? And 25%?
A third. This is a national survey.
Yeah. A third?
A third.
A third said that their best friend was one of their parents. So when I went to college, the idea that my parent would be my best friend would never have crossed my mind. So certainly, I mean, not even, one doesn't have to worry about best versus some other sort of friend or second best. It just wouldn't. And so the students change. And in that way, then the role of the masters and the RAs and the student government changes. And I think when we look to the future, what we start looking to is how the masters and the RAs, et cetera, respond to this. I said before that I think one of the, that the colleges would benefit from being larger, probably the one constraint on that is the ability of the masters and the RAs to respond to the student needs. Because I think there are more demands on the masters and the RAs than there were previously. Having been here for 8 months, maybe I don't really have standing to say that, but that's my impression.
I can follow up on that a little bit. So when I was doing interviews for the 50th anniversary video that I did, I interviewed a Will Rice student who was from the class of 1962, and he was discussing about the role of the masters when the college system first started. And he said they never really talked with the masters that much unless something bad happened. So when one of his children was at Will Rice about 20 or so years later, he was telling him a story about how he had to go to the master's house to go do something, and he responded with, well, why? What did you do wrong? You know, like the masters are the punishers or something like that. But I feel that the role has definitely changed in the past 50 years or so, seeing as how the master is an integral part of, I would say, any residential college on campus, especially Will Rice for one, where students look to the masters to help with events, to be in a leadership position, whereas 50 years ago, that wasn't necessarily the exact role. They were just there to make sure everything went okay and to fill in if there was a problem. And I feel that Rice has done a good job with the masters that they have chosen through the years. In my 4 years here, there have been wonderful masters at all the colleges, I would say. And I think that will be one of the difficulties with expanding the university to having another college or two, will be, can we find qualified masters? Is there going to be people that want to do this and will do as good of a job as the ones that we currently have had doing that? I think the answer is yes. I think they can be found. It's just a matter of making sure that we do that carefully.
I think going along with that also, I mean, just the changes that have happened in the past 50 years of the role of masters and RAs, I think we need to work in the future, and I'm probably going to steal something Jeremy was going to say, to formalize their roles more. Because I think, you know, are the RAs your best friends, or are they the disciplinarians? Are the masters, you know, someone you can go to with any of your problems, or are they more the parent figure? And I think as we gain more students and more of these issues come up on a daily basis, so we're not driving our poor RAs and masters crazy 24 hours a day, it would help them out and make their lives a lot easier if there was some more formal definition of what their role was within the college, and that was made clear to the students as well, so that we all sort of knew where we stood in relation to each other, so when a question did come up, you know, they didn't have to be bugged at 4 o'clock in the morning if that wasn't what they were supposed to be dealing with.
Did she say everything you wanted to say, or do you have a...
I think the role of masters and RAs are certainly going to change. I think the roles of the masters are going to change primarily because in the future the size is going to grow. It's just going to be more of a bureaucratic job. I think masters have a tremendous amount of work to do with merely answering emails. I think they probably spend many hours a day just merely answering emails. But I think one of the things that we need to think about is that in answer to your question, I think the role of the masters and RAs isn't to take care of students at the college. It's to challenge students at the college. And I would ask another question and say, what is the role of the student? And how can we get in the students we want via the registrar for people who are interested in not only seeking a community, but wanting to challenge themselves and quite frankly, wanting to challenge the world. We talk about self-governance at the college level, but we don't teach self-reliance, in my opinion, to our students. And we need to do a better job of that, I think, in the future.
Yeah, that's an interesting point. I will say that one thing, we've talked about the changing needs of the students. Another aspect of that is the changing expectations of our students. This is another national trend. I mean, the universities 30 years ago, if a student said, I have a problem, universities by and large responded, what are you telling me for? Let's go deal with it. And there's been an understanding across the nation that, in fact, we have to play a role in helping our students, in supporting our students in achieving their goals, even outside of the classroom. And certainly Rice, I think, has led the way. But if we're, you know, we should certainly keep in mind the balance between encouraging a kind of self-reliance that will be necessary post-graduation with the kind of support we're offering here on campus. I want to take this opportunity to open up the floor for questions and comments. You can respond to something that was already discussed or ask another question. And don't say anything until I get to you with the microphone. Okay.
Thank you. I'm Earl Van Zant, Will Rice College, class of 61. And if you count right, that was the first class to go through the entire college system. comment on the discussion of faculty associates. As with so many innovative programs, you sometimes have to be given the authority to fail, of course, without using that word. There probably are some great faculty members who are wonderful professors, instructors, research directors, and lousy social skills. And if you get one of those in that position, it's going to turn everybody off. The students are going to say, hey, if that's what a faculty associate is, who needs them? So there needs to be some way to identify that and cleanly make the break without embarrassing anybody in the situation there. And I guess it applies to masters too. And incidentally, typical of Will Rice, we had fabulous faculty associates my first five years, and a great master too. And I'm glad to see the tradition continues.
A comment and a question. I've been on campus as a staff member for over 15 years, and before we leave the pavilion and rec center idea, I just wanted to give a staff perspective. I don't have a long commute. I live in the neighborhood, but I know for many staff members, it would be wonderful, and for grad students, to have central locations where you could meet someone, either colleagues on campus, or I invite a lot of my U of H friends, my writer friends, my family members to events on campus, whether they be musical, dramatic lectures, some of the wonderful presidential lectures, and so to have some central central locations where the quality of life improves for everybody, and there's less going back and forth in your car, and there's an honest to goodness location you can meet. I think it just helps everybody. And maybe these staff members who are staying around more for more events will come to every college drama, which I'd love to do, but sometimes my schedule doesn't allow, and we'll go to every lecture that an organization promotes on campus. And then my question is, a lot of my background, 9 years, has been in the engineering division, and I wondered, how do the RAs and the academic advisors fit together in the college community? Because I know engineering really worked to pick up the divisional advising, and I wondered, is there steady improvement there and good interaction?
Well, I'm a peer academic advisor, so I did that for a week, so I've worked a lot with the divisional advisors, and they work very hard. You have to be a divisional advisor for a specific college, so a lot of times it's hard finding someone because they'll already be an associate at one college, so even though they're available to do divisional advising, they don't want to do it for another college. So I know we've had a lot of problems in the past getting divisional advisors for each specific college from all the different areas, and also a lot of the divisional advisors feel incredibly overwhelmed because you're throwing, you know, during O-Week, 30 students at them. They have 15-minute appointments that they barely get to know the student's name before they have to hustle them out the door and see the next one. So I think that if we could encourage more, I mean, I know the Academic Advising Office would love if more professors would be advisors, because that would just help lower the burden on everyone and you get some real more quality advising out. But.
It's in steady decline. Some colleges have had a lot of trouble fielding a full slate of advisors. I think maybe this year some colleges weren't able to. Personally, I find the state of advising somewhere between poor, occasionally good, usually fair. There's enough. I mean, I've been somewhat disappointed with the state of advising. So, and I think the pressures we talked about earlier on faculty are very much contributed to this, because the role that the divisional advisor has to do is a big one. And so there's a lot of pressures in the other direction.
I'm about to hand the microphone to someone who knows more about the college system from the inside than I think the rest of us combined.
Yeah, no,
so
we could all sit here, he can take the whole panel.
Hi, I'm Bill Wilson, past RA over at Weiss. We're just extraordinarily lucky, I think, to have this system that was founded 50 years ago. And from what I've been able to read, and certainly I think what you heard, the committee that formed it wasn't really sure how it was going to work. I can say for myself, and I think most of you, if you're honest, we don't really know why it works. But it does amazingly well. And it's going to change. It's not going to stay the way it was or the way it is. But as long as you, everybody here, stays committed to it, I think you'll continue to make it work. And we're really lucky.
I'm John Ambler. I've been an associate. I admire people like Bill. They've given a good part of their life. But I've been an associate at Brown since its founding in 1965, and I've been a divisional advisor. And I was also chair of the committee that recommended divisional advisors as opposed to having all associates advise. And my question is this: how can we improve that system? Ever since surveys of alumni have been held, alumni have complained about poor advising in Rice. And apparently we still don't have it right. And so I'm interested in you undergraduates. What might work better than the present divisional advising system?
I think we need a bigger academic advising department. It's run by two people, essentially. They see all the appointments for every student that has a question about everything. They are completely overwhelmed. For a university our size that, you know, claims that is our focus, that we are a school that concentrates on academics, I think the fact that, you know, that office is so small, and they don't even really have their own, like, unique office. They share it with, like, five other different groups. We need to give that more support. They need more staff members, more people who can be answering our questions. I think they've done a great job trying to recruit students as peer academic advisors at each college. We now have mentors and fellows programs at each college, but there's only so much that, you know, groups of students can do. I think that it just needs to be a bigger department. If that's truly what we are, an academic university, then that's what we need to be putting our weight behind.
Not faculty, but staff.
I mean, think it can be both, but I think that, I mean, the people who do work in the office now also teach classes, but there's so much just sheer paperwork that needs to get done. I think that the office itself just needs to be bigger to help people. There needs to be someone who's just in charge of interpreting rules, so when people come and ask, you know, questions, that, you know, they can be fielded right to that person, and, you know, different interpretations.
And I think the problem is, I'm a divisional advisor for not only the humanities, but the social sciences, of which I know very little, but I'm a divisional advisor for it because we just don't have anyone else to do it at Martel. We have about five people who sign all slips for all people, so you really just don't end up doing any advising at all. But I know when I was an undergraduate, I went to a larger university, but every school at the university had an academic advising department or at least one staff member that you went to. And the problem is, I don't know some of the answers to things for certain schools, and the faculty members in the individual schools and colleges don't necessarily know all of the answers to these things. It's not necessarily a uniform. That's why I tell people at the beginning of the year, you know, this is your course catalog, this is your Bible. Ultimately, I'm not responsible for your graduation, you and this book are. But we need people on campus other than two who understand the book and who can give the same answer to people who have questions. I don't have enough time to actually advise. I sit at lunch and there's a line of about 30 people who need slips. I try to make sure that, you know, they're going to graduate, but ultimately I don't have any time to do that. It just can't be done.
Mike?
Okay. First of all, thanks. I think the divisional advising system as you conceived it is a good idea. I mean, I was a divisional advisor for 15 years or so, and I was always astonished at how no matter how hard I tried, how some of those people in that room that I met in the beginning of the year, how incredibly professional they were. I mean, they would discuss at a very high level what, you know, a course would come up, and I would hear its previous course names, who taught it, its history, how it fit into the requirements. There are some divisional advisors who have done it for decades, and they're very experienced, and they're very much on top of things, and they're terrific. Not everyone. I think actually good advising is actually not that hard. I don't think it takes a tremendous talent. I think it takes putting in some time, listening to students and asking questions about where they want to go in their lives. And then when you don't know the answers to the questions they have about courses to take, you call somebody. It's not so difficult, but it takes some time. And the question is more, I think, about the, it's a values problem. I mean, the university, there's an awful lot of pressure on faculty members to do an awful lot of things, and this is not a high priority.
Yes, Sarah?
I think that the divisional advising is one thing that we could take the colleges out of and have more advisors that can cater to individual students. So, for example, at Baker, we didn't have any social sciences divisional advisors this year, so students did it. And they actually did a really good job. The people who went to them were happy with their classes. They got a lot of advice because students have actually been going through the classes and know a lot about it. But a lot of times students find that the advisor for humanities is a English professor, whereas they want to do something completely different and don't get any help from their divisional advisor. So I think that doing more events like the fair where everyone can talk to their major, people from their major, is great, and that ultimately students will find the people that they need to find. With major advisors, they can go to them and talk to them about their classes and talk to them about different things, but the divisional advising system I don't think is very useful how it is right now, and I don't think a lot of students see their divisional advisor at all after a week.
I can follow up on that. That is completely true about how students don't follow up with their divisional advisor during O week. And O week's not necessarily the right time to do it because these students are thinking about other things at the time. They don't know what they want to do with their life. They just got to college. But having the divisional advising appointment then doesn't really help them because it's more just having the divisional advisor sign off on some classes that they're going to take. They register and then they change them all anyway. So that really doesn't really do much for them. But one thing that has helped is getting student advice on these classes and having students talk to them about what they want to do, and students who have gone through this and who are getting jobs in the next year and who kind of know a little bit about what the undergraduates are going through, because professors don't know the ins and outs of these classes. They don't know which professors are good, and if they do, they can't say. So as students, we can kind of give a unique perspective on that. And one thing that Will Rice has done to do that is through our fellows program. I've been organizing this the past couple years, as we have study breaks with the fellows program and the peer academic advisors. And we have a joint study break, and we bring all of them together. At Will Rice, we have about 30 academic fellows, and we have, I would say, six more distinct peer academic advisors. So we have over 35 students in the room across all majors, all disciplines, who can give advice to freshmen, sophomores, and juniors about what classes they need to take, what classes help them prepare them for summer jobs, what classes help prepare for lab research, what classes help prepare them for after they graduate. So I think the student advice has been tremendously more helpful than any divisional advising advice. And part of that is because students think of divisional advisors only as that person they talked to once during O week and got a form signed. They don't go back to the divisional advisors, and sometimes they can't even really help because they don't really know, they don't always know the answers for what the student is looking for. But a lot of times as students, we kind of know what they're looking for in the immediate future. So I think the students have filled that gap pretty well so far.
Actually, I'd just like to add my own comment to that, because you mentioned that alumni surveys, young alums express a dissatisfaction with academic advising, and that's true, and as do seniors when we ask them when they leave. We also get comparative data from those same questions asked at all of our peer institutions. There is not a single research university in the country which does better in academic advising than we do. They all do uniformly poorly in terms of customer satisfaction. So it's impossible to point to a university where we say, oh, you know what, they've got this one licked. It's a really challenging problem. I think what you're hearing here, I actually would disagree with some of the statements I heard in the extreme nature they were stated. I think what's clear is that faculty bring something to advising that's unique from the faculty perspective. Students bring something to the advising system that only students can bring, and professionals who are experts in the policies and regulations of the university also play an absolutely crucial role in the process. So it's complicated for the students, because to really get a full wealth, you know, take advantage of the full wealth of knowledge represented on campus, you can't rely on just one person or just a handful of people. So it's challenging from both those offering advice and those receiving advice to take advantage of the system. And it would be an easier problem if I could look around at a university and say, you know, we should probably move in that direction. You know, you talk about, I happen to agree that the academic advising office should expand, and I will also state definitively that it will expand over the next few years. But you can, you know, in terms of customer satisfaction, there are two universities that have armies of professional advisors, and in terms of they do, there is actually a slight difference in the polls, but it's, you have to go down to the third decimal place to see it, and so the reality is it costs money to expand the professional advising staff to a large one, and there would probably be some improvement, but it's not clear that we couldn't see a more dramatic improvement in the student life if we were to take those same resources and put them elsewhere. These are the kind of choices we're always making.
So I mean, just to I can't let you have the last word. I think it's true that on average that the advising is maybe not so good, and on average we're as bad as everyone else. But there are some places on this campus where advising is remarkably good, and there are some remarkably good advisors. So once you see that, then I think the excuse for not having that everywhere starts to be deflated a bit.
Patricia.
Hi, Patricia Mahoney, Jones College, 2007. I'm the former Jones president. So I have a question for Dr. Grace. You mentioned when you were talking about the budget, almost mandating 5% of the budget go to some place and 5% go to another place, such as Passport to Houston or other events. But as a former college president and seeing this, where does the line get drawn where self-governance ends and mandates begin?
Well, I wouldn't mandate 100% of the budget, but I think if the university has priorities that have been outlined in, say, the call to conversation, and that's outreach, or if the college has priorities as far as intellectual ferment, that we could mandate, it wouldn't be that large of a deal to mandate 5 to 10 to 20 to even 40% of our budget to that. How the individual college does it is up to the individual college. But, you know, like at Martel, one of the cultural events we had this year, I think, was a monster truck rally. And I don't know that that really counts as culture, right? And I don't know that subsidizing tickets to a monster truck rally is the same as maybe encountering, an actual culture in a very vibrant cultural city. And I just think we could do a better job of that. And I think just saying, hey, these are some priorities. We're not asking you to spend it all in this way, but 5% or spend $1,500 of your budget to bring in 1 to 2 faculty members from a different university in the country to lecture for an evening to your college. And then who you decide to bring in is up to you, but I think we could really make some very interesting things happen that way. That was my only suggestion. And I'm not bashing on the monster truck rally.
Yeah,
actually you are.
It is culture. You're right.
I was with you right up until the monster truck rally.
But you know, I think we could do a better job.
I guess your comment just hit a note with me, where just a broader sense of that self-governance of, is it the university's decision to tell us how we spend our money, or is it up to the students how the students spend the money?
Well, it's the university's decision to give you the money to spend, so yes.
Okay.
Yeah, I think the answer is yes.
One of you, yeah.
Justine Mangit, a sophomore at Brown College. I actually had two kind of questions. One of them was actually in regards to the associates program. I know we kind of brushed up on the graduate students a little bit, and I wanted to get actually an opinion about this was, I don't know, implementing the kind of a graduate associate program in the sense, like, we have faculty associates, staff, and then community associates, but how about integrating the graduate students? You know, I mean, then it's like, they're the creepy grad students. You know, that's what people hear, okay? But I mean, it's just like, bringing them in, because a lot of them I feel like would want to come in, so I would like to, I'm personally just hear people's opinions on that and see if, you know, what people actually think about that. So
what is your field of study? Are you a grad student?
Oh no.
Oh, oh, I'm sorry. I wasn't listening. At the beginning, apparently. No, I was listening.
It's okay.
I was just gonna say, I mean, maybe it would be maybe college presidents or could approach the different schools and say, we would like you to have a Wednesday lunch with us or that kind of thing. I think it's a great idea. I think we should include more of them. I don't know. I mean,
we had a grad student help us with our Powderpuff team. You know, they were helped be our coaches and things like that. I think it's great when you can get any involvement because they're not that much older. So in social settings, so it's not so much like the junior dance where all the adults are on one side, you know, all the kids are on the other side. It's more, you know, it'd be great if we had all.
Absolutely. I mean, the college, the ideal of the college is that of a community of all different types of students, different generations. I think it's a wonderful idea.
I guess my second question was actually, talking to other students, I hear a lot about, this goes into McMurtry starting up soon, but I hear a lot of people being like, oh, you know, bigger college, more people on campus, this isn't why I came to Rice, you know, this and that. So I was just kind of curious to see if any of you agreed with this opinion, and if you didn't agree with this opinion, you know, what would you say to those students that say, you know, we're going to lose that, you know, professor to student ratio, you know, this is why I came for the, you know, cheap education, for, you know, a quality education, and, you know, not as many students. So
I don't think it's a particularly constructive criticism, because it's going to happen. McMurtry is going to be built. They're going to break ground. It's going to be the number of students it is, and nothing that we do can change that at this point. I think what we can do is, you know, Jeremy stole my line earlier, is it's really up to the undergraduates and especially the underclassmen to shape how those changes take place. I mean, it's going to be the freshmen and sophomores who are the ones populating McMurtry in the new college. And if you don't want those things that you so hold dear about this college experience to change, then you have to be the ones making sure that those things don't change and demanding things from the administration and using forums like this one to bring your concerns about, because they do want to listen. They want to hear our opinions and take that into account. But we are truly the ones who shape our own experiences. And if everyone is being negative about it and saying how this is going to be such a detriment. We're not working towards figuring out how to solve those specific problems or how to make it so that that isn't something that harms our experience.
Any other responses?
I think the only problem will come if all the colleges are different sizes, have different resources, different budgets, and there's just a huge disparity maybe between rooms or what the colleges are like in general, because each college does have its own personality, I guess, and really what they like and what they don't like to plan and do. But I think that it will be hard for a college like Baker, who has 300 students, to compete with a college with, you know, almost two times that. So
it won't be almost two times.
Well,
now you're just setting up a straw man.
That's true. It's just going to be, if the budgets are still distributed the way they are right now per student, the new college will be able to plan a lot more events than a college like Baker can, which is great. And I think that, you know, more resources is great, but it will be interesting to see how that changes and how the students at that college perceive life in the college system as opposed to Baker, where it's more of just a smaller community.
I'll just add my one point. My concern is actually we won't see enough of a change. And what I mean by that is, for me, I have an office where the window looks out over the academic quad, which is a ghost town most of the day, even when students are in session. I mean, you know, we just don't see people out in the academic quad. We admitted 100 additional students after Katrina. We took 100 students from Tulane, and I don't know that anybody noticed any real difference in the campus. It's clear we have lots of room to grow without changing the nature of our campus. And my hope is actually that we're growing enough to see a difference on the campus, to see people around, and to make the campus feel a little bit more like a dynamic, constantly vibrant intellectual and cultural community. The other point you raised, which is keeping the close relationship between students and faculty, I think is a crucial one. And it ties directly, but at Rice, that's never been something that's been housed directly only in the classrooms. It's something that's taken place largely in the colleges. And so it's a very timely question, and then, you know, this question of, it's another challenge for the colleges to evolve so that they will remain a place where students and faculty will share a type of relationship that simply can't occur left on its own in the classroom. But it's an important question. Now, there are two hands that were up for a while, so I'm gonna start with you.
Thank you.
We're wrapping up, so let's everyone try to keep it brief, and we're...
Understand. I'm Mike Ross, a Baker graduate from long ago, and we had graduate student associates when we were there, so it's certainly something that could happen, and I would hope that the interaction, and maybe even should have staff associates at some level. The college system was one of the best parts of my education. My favorite profs were people I never took classes from, just would end up having lunch with. I am disturbed. I don't live anywhere near here, so this is the first time I've heard that McMurtry sounds like it's going to be significantly larger than the other colleges. And I guess if that's true, I think that's a bad move. You know, and I would hope that the new colleges do have a positive. I mean, you got to be larger. And that can be a good thing, but if you have a disparity, I think I agree with Sara. Us Baker people stay, understand the world in this way. I mean, you don't want to have Rice end up being like a New York City park where there's, you know, people all out, but just because there's people all out. But you know, the real great situation of what Rice is a wonderful environment. And I am also disturbed to hear that the faculty associates are in decline, because that was such a big part of my experience. And I would just hope that the administration gives weight to faculty associate type participation, because that is important to the total Rice experience.
Thank you. Any responses?
Hi, I actually have a little bit to say, but first I wanted to sort of agree with the girl, I guess she was the former president of Jones. It really terrifies me to hear the sound of 5% going to this, 5% going to that. I mean, if we aren't behaving in a cultured manner, I don't think you can force it. They're going to find a way around these percentages. And if you want to empower student government, it's really you have to give them 100% control, and they will take on their own responsibility to bring culture to the college. I don't think that you can start forcing these things. Kind of to tie together, we were discussing a long while back about fringe groups getting involved in the colleges, the one-third that seems to get lost deep OC. I think that issue and the issue of the relationship between students and faculty is actually related, and it all comes down to O-Week. And I think we all forget, especially the older I'm just a sophomore, so I remember how malleable you are during O-Week in the first few weeks of school. You come in and you can do a complete 180 from who you were in high school and who you were in your hometown. So I think it's really important to remember the power of O-Week in bringing all of these smaller groups and kind of more diverse backgrounds together. And I know that O-Week has made a significant shift in the last few years, and we've lost track of what that shift is doing to our freshmen. And there has been some changes in the way the freshmen first semester have been behaving. And I think all of that is closely related to the fact that we are losing our institutional control or just impression on these people who are perhaps not part of the mainstream. So we should probably be looking at that in terms of where can we start, where can we instill these values and these priorities from the beginning, and taking O-Week a little more seriously and perhaps trying to remedy some of the harsh decisions that were made a few years ago in towards that goal. I mean, this is my perspective. I don't know
Can
if any
say
of
what
you
harsh
have.
Decisions you're referring to?
Well, I'm actually I obviously came after the decisions were made, so I'm not completely up on all of it. But from what I understand, there was sort of the inclination to make sure that there was no hint of what's the term? Hazing students, and then there was a lot of, like, they cleaned up the scavenger hunt and a lot of the activities, and so the students who perhaps like to push boundaries didn't have a way to push boundaries during O-Week, and so they learned to push boundaries in a way that wasn't really tied to their college and their support system at their college, you know, things like that. I think it's a subtle shift. It really is, but it can make all the difference. And I mean, even just in terms of intellectualizing O-Week, I think we could probably make some positive changes there. So, I mean, I don't know how, that's kind of a comment, but I'd love to hear responses to it, if anyone has them.
Well, I'm not really clear on what you're trying to say when you say that we should be instilling values during O-Week, but then we've also, by instituting not hazing people and taking away the fun aspects of O-Week, which is I think what you were trying to get at, that somehow we're not instilling our college values. We're not here to have a party all the time and, you know, do cheers for our college. We're going to an intellectual institution. We're, you know, we're adults. We're going to college. I don't think, you know, I think that they're trying to make O-Week so that it is more of a chance where it's a transition from being in high school to going to college. I think the fact that we're trying to emphasize more on the academics is essential because, you know, as they were talking about, when we were talking about divisional advisors, sometimes it seems worthless during O-Week that you meet with 15 minutes with this person because you change your mind, but maybe if students were giving more of a chance to, you know, explore the academic aspects of what they expected to be doing when they get to college, that could change. I know Brian and I were interviewing people to be O-Week PAAs, and a lot of those people, you know, who are trying to be the academic advisors in their own college said the thing that they didn't like about O-Week was they didn't feel like they got enough academic advising out of the entire week. You're here for an entire week, and they didn't feel like they got to talk to people about their classes enough or that they learned enough about the rules and how to even graduate Rice, that they had to sort of pick that up as they went along, and that was something they were missing. I think O-Week is changing. I think it's a good thing. I don't think that we need to do more, you know, culturing people into your college. I think that it's important to also culture people into the university and treat them like adults.
It has been said that the greatest hindrance to innovation is the resistance to change. And so I find myself falling prey to this a lot because, hopeless romantic that I am, you know, people talk about the new aspects of the new colleges and how it will affect our dynamic, and a lot of people have received the new colleges and, in general, change to the college system very negatively. This is just my perspective as a freshman. And as much as I would like to say that that's true, that adding more students, you know, to the university is going to change the whole reason why I came here and Rice just won't be unique and special anymore, I think that a lot of what I've heard today and a lot of what I've heard from other students is essentially arguing slippery slope. If we make this little change here, then this big change will happen in the end and screw us all over. And so I think as we approach the future of the college system, it's very important for us to delineate what is slippery slope and what is innovation. How, you know, the little things that we do now that people respond negatively to because they are different may not, in the end, you know, invalidate what is good and right about the college system. Mr. Wilson, Dr. Wilson said earlier, you know, it works. We don't know why it works. It just works. And it does work very well. But I think that until, you know, you can really put a finger on why it works, we shouldn't be so very afraid to change it. And so, you know, I wonder where is that line between being afraid of, you know, kicking ourselves in the end by little changes that we make now, where does that line separate, you know, from innovation?
It's interesting because in the beginning of the college system, it was received very negatively by students, as far as I can tell by reading and what I've talked to with people. And people were very resistant to change. They thought it was going to destroy the view of class at Rice, like seniors, freshmen, all of that. But I think it's important that, I mean, it will be interesting to see how the big colleges are received and how students in those colleges perceive the college system. But ultimately, it's going to happen and something's going to change. And the other colleges are supposed to get bigger as well, so we'll see how it goes.
I think the answer is that there's an awful lot of smart, talented people, both students and faculty and administrators, who are deeply committed to the college system. And so it will adapt. And because of that commitment, it will survive and thrive, even if it changes form.
You know, I think that's a good topic to end on. As Sara was saying, if you read the Thresher through the decades, we've destroyed Rice multiple times. We destroyed Rice when we established the college system. We destroyed Rice when the colleges went co-ed. We destroyed Rice when we built the surveries. And we'll probably destroy Rice multiple times during your stay here. And I hope it will have similarly positive effect every time we do so. This conversation's about, you know, the last comment about O-Week is an important one. We didn't talk a lot about O-Week, but O-Week plays a very special role in Rice, and it's probably worthy of a long discussion on its own, and I hope we will get the chance to talk about O-Week and all the other topics we've talked about. I think we're well over time, and we should, I know you all have very busy weekends. I appreciate you all coming here. I wish you all well tonight and tomorrow, beer bike. I hope it doesn't rain as much as it's expected to, and have a wonderful, safe, and fun weekend.
This program is protected by copyright and may not be redistributed in whole or in part without the express written consent of Rice University Digital Media Services.